Welcome everyone to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's 16th meeting of 2021. I've received no apologies for this morning's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed. Our second item today is an evidence session with Nick Finn, the Director of Public Health Science and Medical Director of Public Health Scotland, as part of our scrutiny of the Provisional Common Framework on Public Health Protection and Health Security. Good morning to Nick Finn. Thank you for coming along this morning. I guess our initial question is what the changes will be that will be brought around about by the framework and how this affects public health in Scotland.
And develop. One is improve the exchange of information between England and the other two devolved administrations. Try and pool data to look at research issues such as Omicron and its potential impact on people's health. So by pooling our data, we get the answer quicker and in a more robust way. The third one is to look at our cross-border arrangements. Microbes don't respect borders, and we've seen how rapidly SARS-CoV has spread globally, in common with many other diseases. So making sure that we have good cross-border cooperation both within the UK and with the EU is going to be critical going forward. And in the third area is to look at our research priorities and agree a common focus for research. So I think these are four potential benefits to the new ways of working. I don't think anyone would disagree in principle with the objectives. As ever, it's the application where probably we need to do some further work.
Yeah, and obviously my colleagues have got some quite detailed questions, particularly about our role as a committee in scrutiny of decisions, because that is really something, having looked at some frameworks in other portfolios over the course of the last couple of years, that role for all the parliaments of the four nations and their influence on the decision making process or their knowledge of that's one of the issues. I mean, are you able to elaborate on any potential there? I mean, where does the Scottish Parliament and indeed the Scottish Government fit in the decision making process?
There are four tiers, if you like. There is what we call the Health Protection Oversight Committee, which is representatives from Scottish Government and Public Health Scotland, along with the other agencies and government officials, will meet to discuss and agree issues. The next level above that is where I attend, and Michael Kellett attends for Scottish Government, and the other three health protection agencies and government officials attend. And that is a sort of very strategic level, and that will meet maybe two or three times a year to agree the oversight and of the plan. There's a third level, which is the English, Scottish, Welsh and Northern Ireland CMOs group. And then feeding into that is a ministerial group. Composition of that is, as yet, as I understand it, still to be agreed, but it will be an important one for resolution.
Yeah, and I guess that everything you've said makes perfect sense about alignment and responses to any public health threat, and we've seen that in action with COVID. But should there be an instance where there maybe one of the nations wants to have a different response for reasons that we don't know yet, because we have to take everything as it comes, does the framework allow for that?
Yes, I mean, clearly there is still a degree of autonomy within each country. I mean, wherever possible, consensus is the desired way forward, both from a communications and communicating policy and operational issues. But as we've seen with Omicron, there are divergences if you look at each of the four nations across the UK in how they've interpreted and responded. I think one of the key issues is that we've seen the health systems in each of the four nations diverge, and they're now quite different, you know, if you were to look at each one. So I can't see how you can have a very rigid approach. It needs to be flexible to allow to take account of the various systems.
And presumably the response to COVID, the COVID pandemic has informed quite a lot of how the framework's been put together.
Yes, discussions had started prior to COVID because obviously Brexit has been on the agenda for some time. So work had started to look at what this might look like. And my understanding is that Scottish Government and the agencies that existed before Public Health Scotland had appropriate input into that. I myself only started just under 12 months ago, so I'm getting up to speed as quickly as I can with issues and events in Scotland.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to Deputy Convener Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to all those joining this morning. I suppose following on from the initial kind of question there and conversation, my questions really focus on international relations more broadly. So I suppose maybe to kind of set the scene a bit in terms of this topic, you know, will the approach to international relations that has been set out in the Memorandum of Understanding be required often? Is that something that you feel we will?
Before I moved to Scotland, I actually worked with what was Public Health England and the Health Protection Agency before that. And one of my roles was actually as the national focal point, both for the international health regulations and the national focal point for ECDC, which is the sort of scientific advisory body for the EU. So I'm quite familiar with the processes involved in that. And my understanding is that negotiations are currently ongoing for a memorandum of understanding with ECDC, which would allow us access to various scientific committees, networks, to share data, both the country level and across the EU. But those are all currently under negotiation, under discussion. And one of the consequences, if you like, of the Brexit has been greater reliance on what we call the International Health Regulations 2005. And that was established by WHO really to allow the exchange of information on issues of that are considered serious public health issues. It doesn't restrict it to infectious diseases. It actually includes environmental issues as well. So that has been the sort of stable platform that's been used pending further agreement on access to what was called EWRS, which was the Early Warning and Response System, to which the UK was a member and to which Scotland actually fed in, and we submitted our data directly into Europe.
Thank you for that. Can I just follow up if I can, just on that? So your sense, I suppose, is that perhaps similar to your first answer, that we would very much be aiming to have a more collaborative approach and an approach where we come to a consensus rather than perhaps having to look to what's in the letter of the memorandums of understanding when they come forward. I mean, is it your sense that we would much rather find a consensus essentially on these issues?
Yes. I, as the national focal point, when I was in Colindale, which is the Centre for Infectious Disease Surveillance, there was a tendency for the scientific expertise to rest within BHE. And one of the things I did at a very early stage was to start asking the devolved administrations to take leads in various areas. And that's something I'd want to see developed in the discussion with the EU around the Memorandum of Understanding. I'm not sure we're quite there yet, because the current technical committee has got 15 representatives from UKHSA, but has only got one from Wales, two from Northern Ireland, and three from Scotland. So I think there is some work about how we make sure that we're adequately represented in those technical discussions. But it's very early days yet. And as I say, collaboration is the way forward, I believe.
Thank you. And if I may, convener, I suppose you know, that's very helpful. And I think that consensus approach and that desire to get this right from the start, I think is really, really helpful. I suppose just a hypothetical where, for example, we wouldn't be able to get perhaps agreement between the four nations on an international treaty or an international action, concerted action. I mean, is your view that we would need to invoke the kind of resolution, conflict resolution type procedures, or would the UK government seek to kind of act unilaterally? I mean, I think in terms of the conversation we've just had around consensus, I think that's certainly something we would be aiming towards, but we know that often we can't always get that. So just keen to get your sense of that.
I can't really answer that. That would be policy issue determined by the seriousness of the issue, how important it was, and that would obviously be something that the Scottish government would want to take a view on. And I think it would be at that level it would be invoked. But clearly, wherever possible, it would be trying to get a resolution at some other tier in the sort of administrative structure.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you, Paul. And I'll move on to questions around information sharing from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to everyone. And good morning, Dr. Finn. I'm interested in information sharing, and as far as we now have different scientific advisory groups in each administration, and I'm sure many of the members will know each other, and I think that we probably want to pursue a collaborative process using non-legislative measures rather than legislative approaches, which is part of this memorandum of understanding. So I'm interested in how good is information sharing then between all four nations. You've said that there are three representatives in Scotland, but 15 in the whole group, and only one from Wales and one from Ireland. So how is information shared then currently, if there's a top-heavy approach, I suppose, in the UK compared in England compared to Scotland and Wales and Ireland?
That particular example was the ECDC Memorandum of Understanding Technical Group, and I mentioned it really just to illustrate where we've been and where we and what we have to do. I would want to make sure that that mix included some of the expertise that we have in Scotland, and as I say, it is early days, and the first meeting of the Health Protection Committee only took place a couple of months ago. So it is very early days. There is a recognition. I know many of the people well, and while it's not a case of relying on who you know, but I know them, and they do genuinely want to collaborate. So I think it's about having those discussions, and if, of course, we get them further, then we will have to sort of escalate that appropriately.
Yeah, thank you. As a former healthcare nurse in the operating theatre, I am very keen that clinicians and scientists and experts all work together, because knowledge sharing is how we're going to tackle this pandemic and any future concerns to suppress any future pandemics. I know we've even got a pandemic committee that's been established as well in Scotland. So we've got lots of experts around the table. Are we good at information sharing at the moment, or do you think there might be some, how do we like avoid duplication if different people are doing same pieces of work, for instance? How do we prevent that kind of duplication?
I think it would be fair to say that I could look around and identify probably some areas where duplication is currently occurring. And I think that's probably a reflection on where we are with the development of the common framework. One of the key elements is a common understanding on research and trying to identify areas where, you know, one country might take a lead and other countries would come together to support it. We're not there yet, but it is something we need to look at and ensure that it is addressed. There is a tendency, if things aren't sort of addressed at the outset, it can sometimes be forgotten about. And so I do think it will be important we make sure that we are involved at an appropriate level and, you know, contributing in a meaningful way across the UK.
And just a final question, convener, if that's okay. If we're looking at surveillance and different data and how I think it is necessary to compare, I suppose, numbers of COVID cases and types of how people's behaviour is that may have led to outbreak. For instance, sometimes we hear of people that are, you know, against wearing face coverings, for instance, or so part of the data, if we're looking at surveillance in the different parts of the four UK nations, are we able to then make informed, good comparative decisions which show that, well, one way might be a better way than another to help inform the best way to deal with this pandemic?
Yes, I can give you a couple of examples. There's a project called Siren, which is a piece of research work that Scotland actually is, you know, punching above its weight in, because I think we're contributing about 4,500 or 5,000 individuals to support the Siren study. And this Siren study is looking at infections in healthcare workers, the impact of wearing personal protective equipment, and looking at reinfection and vaccine effectiveness waning over time. So it's a good example of where we are actually working collaboratively. Another example is where, for instance, for the new Omicron variant, agreeing fairly rapidly across the four countries a common case definition so that we're comparing apples with apples rather than apples with oranges. There are slight challenges because clearly with the divergence of the way that the health services have developed, how data is collected, the timeliness of it, and the data it's reported does present slight problems with getting a truly accurate representation. But wherever possible, definitely we share common case definitions that make the sort of comparison you're describing possible.
Thank you. And on this topic, Emma, I'm assuming that you're quite happy for me to pass on to our colleagues to ask some supplementary questions on this?
Yes,
can
sure.
Can I bring in Sandesh Bohani? Sandesh.
Thank you, Kavina. There are many research and cancer databases that Scotland and England have, or Scotland doesn't have and England does have. And if we were to combine and work together, we would have a much larger pool of data and a far improved set of data. An example of this is the Fracture Liaison Service database that we don't have here in Scotland at the moment, but we do in England. And to me, it makes sense to join and have a big database. So will this encourage more shared database, more shared databases and more shared work between our nations?
The focus of the MOU is around health protection. So fractures would slightly be outside the scope of the current MOU. I've no reason to see that couldn't be developed over time, but at the current time, the focus is health protection, and therefore what you're describing would be outside the scope of it. Having said that, yes, obviously, the more sharing of data we can achieve, quicker we potentially identify issues and problems, and the quicker we identify beneficial treatments. But I do think data sharing is something that we should be pushing. There is an organisation called UKHDR, which is a research organisation across UK, And in fact, they have been contributing, giving Public Health Scotland funding to look at how we improve our infrastructure, our information technology infrastructure, so that we can share data with clinicians, with researchers, with valid researchers across the UK and even internationally. So there is the embryonic start of this initiative about greater sharing, and certainly IT capability. It is something within our grasp. Key issues are probably are making sure that we comply with GDPR, which is the General Data Provision regulations, and that any data is handled appropriately. So fully support that, but currently the health protection MOU would be outside the remit of that particular area.
Thank you. And can I bring in Sue Weber?
Thanks, convener. Yes, nice to see you, Mr. Finn, today. I've certainly had a lot of correspondence in my inbox about the secondary breast cancer audit, one that the Scottish patients aren't contributing to. So that last question from my colleague was very pertinent. I'm going to go back a little bit in terms of, you know, what are the key lessons in terms of key changes in policy divergence that, you know, the four nations have learned perhaps from the current pandemic and how we've handled it in the past, and are they reflected in the framework? And I'm thinking mostly in the context of the Scottish election study that came out last week from the University of Edinburgh that said there was a really poor understanding of the Scottish Government's facts messaging versus the hands, face, space messaging that came from Public Health England. So I was just wondering, given that sort of context, given that we've heard of collaborativeness and the consensus we're seeking, do you think we might be a bit more aligned going forward?
I think it's very early days. The first meeting of the Health Protection Committee was, I think, in October, and that's really agreeing a work programme. The work programme has identified 11 areas. One of those is about reviewing disease notifications across the four nations. And Scotland and Wales have been allocated the lead for that. Other areas include things like health protection, development of workforce, education, etc. Communication is not on that list, but I think one of the key messages for me coming out of the COVID pandemic is we do need to pay more attention to the behavioural aspects of getting messages out. Mm-hmm. I was one of the incident directors in Public Health England pandemic, the COVID pandemic response. And at a very early stage, we recognised that assumptions that were being made about communications were perhaps not borne out by the research that had been undertaken by many of the behavioural scientists. So one of the key messages was to utilise behavioural scientists and the information that they have developed in a way that helps get these communications across. Mm-hmm. Now, I wasn't in Scotland at that particular time, so I can't really comment on the approach that was taken at that point. But certainly having those insights from behavioural scientists, I think, is key. And certainly the pandemic committee been established in Scotland, there are one or two important behavioural scientists on that committee, mm-hmm. and it's something we are aware needs to be addressed.
Thank you. Thank you, Sue.
Can we move on to as I trailed her, Gillian Mackay is going to be asking questions around consultation and scrutiny. Gillian.
Thank you, convener. So consultation on the framework took place, and what could you tell us what issues were raised by parties during the consultation, and have these since been addressed?
Unfortunately, I'm not able to fully address that. Many of the consultations took place prior to my appointment, and I can certainly, if the committee would wish, can certainly try and identify that. You know, speaking to colleagues, and provide that information separately. But as I say, prior to my appointment, I'm really unable to comment on that.
Thank you. It would be good to follow up with that if we can at some point, convener. I know the convener has touched on this a bit earlier, but do you think the implementation of the framework will have an impact on parliamentary scrutiny and decision making in this policy area? And if you do, what impact do you think this would be?
I can't really comment on that, I'm sorry. As I say, I'm still familiarising myself with the current system. And as I said, in the MOU, one of the proposals is to look at how ministers and parliament are involved in that scrutiny. It's one of the issues that has been highlighted that needs to be addressed. But as I say, the detail of that is not yet available. Discussions are ongoing.
Thank you. That's me for now, convener. Thank you.
Yeah, and that certainly seems like an issue that maybe I can take to our conveners group, because obviously we've had common frameworks before us in the last year or so, and there has probably been quite a lot of lessons that we can learn from that, which might inform how we feel about the way that scrutiny should happen. So we'll take that away. Thank you. In terms of cross-border cooperation, I've got some questions from Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Dr. Finn. Does Public Health Scotland believe the arrangements within the Trade and Cooperation will facilitate adequate participation of the UK in controlling cross-border threats to or from its closest neighbours?
It's an area where, prior to Brexit, we had extremely good relations. Many of us knew individual focal points within each of the countries, and there was a system called the Early Warning and Response System, which allowed member states to communicate in a confidential way with other member states to highlight potential issues and even share information on cases of concern. And that might be something like a case of tuberculosis, who had left the UK, was untreated, and therefore may present a potential hazard to the country they were going to, and vice versa. So the EWRS was a means of country-to-country communication, and it was also a means of informing WHO and ECDC bigger issues and that wider information sharing. It is a gap that's not been fully addressed through the international health regulations, but I know it is one of the areas that's being pursued in the Memorandum of Understanding with ECDC, and is hoped that very shortly we should get access to a new version of something called EPIS, which was the epidemiology. I remember what the P stands for, the information system, EPIS, and that would be called EpiPulse, and that would allow that timely sharing. We do have access at the moment to EWRS for coronavirus and flu, and that's recognising the mutual benefit in sharing that information brings both to Europe and to the UK. However, if you were to look at certain maps of Europe, and you were to look for the UK data or even the Swiss data, there's just a grey mark. So there is still some work to do to get some of our data integrated in a way that would allow that comparison, which can be, you know, can be fairly critical in understanding our progress towards controlling and responding to infections.
Thank you, Dr. Finn. And in the same regard, do you think there are any other gaps that we need to consider or that we need to strengthen moving forward?
One of the gaps that I hope will be strengthened through this MOU is the scientific collaborations. We have been part of something like 16 special interest groups, which would meet, come up with a common approach to some of the big infectious disease issues. And that did two things. One, it allowed the standardisation of the data, and two, it allowed a common approach to some of the common issues. At the moment, we're not part of those unless we have particular expertise that the EU wishes to access. But developing and being part of those networks will be really important going forward in terms of sharing that knowledge and coming to that common understanding. But that's probably one of the other gaps, this participation in these expert networks.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Just pick you up there, the expert networks, was that as a, you know, were those the networks that were in place as a result of collaboration across the EU, Dr. Finn?
Yes, they were supported and sponsored by ECDC, which would provide the Secretariat, host the meetings and facilitate the gathering of these experts to reach consensus or recommendations on specific issues in those 17 disease areas that have been identified.
Thank you, that's really helpful. Can I come to Stephanie Callaghan? Stephanie, can I just stop you there, because I realised that there's a couple of members that are wanting to come in. Emma, you said you had a supplementary question there, and then I'll come to Stephanie. Apologies.
Yes, please, convener. Thanks. It was just a quick supplementary on similar to Stu Weber's question about hands-face space. We have test and protect in Scotland, and then it's track and trace, or test, trace and isolate in England. So I am interested in what work will be done or collaboratively about looking at whether TTI worked or test and protect, and people's understanding and adherence to the guidance, because that is important. I think that messaging is achievable in order to help tackle the pandemic. So I'm interested in what collaboration and in looking at further behavioural aspects of dealing with these important messages.
In any sort of event like this, you know, major incident or pandemic event, there will be what we call lessons learned undertaken. In Scotland, we've already done some of that, looking, having an internal focus. But one of the things that would be really important is to carry that out on a UK basis. Now, I'm not aware of any work that is currently being planned, but that is certainly something that could be picked up by the Health Protection Oversight or the Health Protection Committee itself, if it was felt that that would be, and I suspect it will be, important in learning lessons for any future pandemics. There's the inquiry that has just been launched. The lead has just been identified in Scotland, and there will be the UK inquiry or England inquiry imminently as well. And part of that will be about understanding what was done and how well it worked, and asking fairly detailed questions, I imagine, along the lines that you're suggesting. But it would be better if we started that work before then, rather than waiting for an inquiry. As I say, we don't know when the next pandemic will be, and it's really important we do get those lessons to learn for any future events.
Thank you. And if I can come to a final theme of questioning around the resources from Stephanie Callaghan. Stephanie.
Thank you very much, convener. And good morning, Dr. Finn, and thanks for joining us this morning. As part of the Memorandum of Understanding, the Shared Work Programme must be delivered within existing resources. So I'm wondering whether you feel that's realistic, whether existing resources are adequate, and are there any circumstances where you feel that could become challenging? Thanks.
An interesting question, because if you look at the health protection resource available in Scotland as a baseline, it's about 90, 100 people. If you look at in England, you're probably talking about several thousand. So there is quite a disparity there. The three areas that Scotland has been identified to take a lead on within the programme that's been set by the Health Protection Committee is to review disease notifications, analyse the four nation working groups, and really to look at genomics, which is an evolving science, in terms of collaborations, cooperation, sharing of data sets and data information. Those are big pieces of work. And certainly at the moment, and I can only speak for Public Health Scotland, we would be extremely hard pressed to contribute in a sort of meaningful way to those pieces of work and reviews. Clearly, we would prioritise it because the reviewing the disease notifications, that's not been done for over 10 years. There are some changes that a review may benefit. We may be able to identify in a review that would help improve things. But I do worry that if the current COVID response carries on, our capacity to adequately respond may not be optimal. That said, this is a collaboration between Public Health Scotland and Scottish Government, and it's clearly how that work is divided will need to be discussed further.
Okay, thanks. That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. We don't seem to have any more questions from colleagues, so I just want to thank Nick Finn for his time this morning with us. We're going to take a break and suspension ahead of meeting with the Cabinet Secretary at 11 o'clock. Thank you very much, Dr. Finn.
Thank you.
Welcome back to the Health, Social Care and Sport Committees. Our third item today on the agenda is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care as part of our scrutiny of the budget for 2022-23. And a welcome to the committee, Humza Yousaf, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, who's joined by Richard McCallum, Director of Health, Finance and Governance for the Scottish Government. Good morning to you both. Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to, I suppose, ask you that very broad question about how the budget that's in front of us today starts to put in place funding for the government's manifesto commitments from earlier this year.
Thank you very much, Convener. First and foremost, good morning to all of you and all the members present. I hope you're all keeping safe and keeping well. And although I'm pleased to be at committee, of course, as always, it's a shame it has to be done virtually, given the constraints that are upon us. I look forward to being with you face to face. It's interesting that the question you ask, Convener, is a really good one. What I would say is that the budget we have put in place helps us to build upon the manifesto commitments we've already achieved in this year. And it's important to recognise that in the first 100 days we already made an incredible amount of progress in terms of meeting some of our manifesto commitments, abolishing dental charges for under 26. Those who are under 26, that went even further beyond what we promised actually to do initially in the first 100 days. Introducing the paramedic bursary, £10,000 bursary, which I know members right across the committee were very supportive of, putting in place the first steps for the National Care Service. No doubt I'll come back to that and touch upon that. Many other commitments that we managed to bring forward in the space of 100 days, including, for example, the pay rise for not just the Dental for Change staff, but also doctors and dentists too. So there's a lot we've done in this financial year that we hope to build upon for the next financial year, and the budget goes into great detail. And one of the key significant reforms that we hope to be able to progress and take forward will undoubtedly be the National Care Service. It will be the biggest public sector reform in the devolution era, I suspect, and will be fully operational by, we hope, the end of the Parliament. But we're putting in place some of the appropriate building blocks for that. Also, crucially, we have in there, again, funding to help us progress with the National Recovery Plan, that increase that you've seen to boards, again, which I can go into detail of if necessary. That, of course, helps to drive us in terms of that recovery, because we need to make sure we're recovering, as well as, of course, dealing with the effects of the pandemic. And then, you know, the capital, there's a lot more I could say, obviously, on resource, but for brevity, on capital, there's some important projects you can see, again, within the capital allocation, whether that's Parkhead Health Centre, the Bridge and Anchor project, some money to progress the replacement of Monklands, which is, of course, much needed as well. The big uncertainty, and again, I'm sure we'll get into the detail of this, but the big uncertainty continues to be the lack of transparency from the UK government in relation to COVID funding. And we desperately need that, because as we all know, and this meeting being conducted virtually is testament to that we are not through the pandemic yet.
Thank you. And Julie Mackay is going to ask for specifically questions on COVID-19. But I did one of the things that obviously is very obvious when you look at the budget allocations is that the COVID-19 spending last year significant, this year there's nothing against it, and obviously there's some confusion, to put it mildly, about the allocation of money that's coming from the UK government, announcements made last week, but actually there's been the dispute over whether that is money that's already been allocated and has already been accounted for in the budget, or whether that is money that is still to come. I mean, the health budget, that has an impact on the health budget, because presumably that's going to be allocated to things like the vaccination booster programme. I mean, can you give us some clarity on what's happening there?
I wish I could, Convener, I suppose, which is the exact point that you're making. Look, I mean, I won't delve too much on what happened last week, but it was extremely poor that in the midst of a global pandemic, in the midst of, or certainly at the foothills of another wave, that these kind of silly political games get played, that when the First Minister stands on her feet, then there's a kind of press release from Treasury claiming that there'll be new money when it was nothing of the sort. And not only nothing of the sort, but a potential reduction in the consequentials that are coming our way. And these consequentials are vital in being able to, as you rightly say, deal with the effects of the pandemic. But crucial the tools that we have in our armoury against the virus, such as vaccinations, such as test and protect, these consequentials are so vital to making sure that we are best equipped to deal with the virus. Now, in terms of the government spending review, the COVID consequentials were far less than we had expected them to be, given how much has already been spent in fighting this virus and the fact that the virus has not gone away yet. And so, you know, we really need desperate certainty from the Treasury about the amounts, about how we think that will be spent. And I push, as you can imagine, the Secretary of State for Health in my regular Four Nations calls on this, as do, frankly, the Welsh and the Northern Irish. And in fairness, he's always constructive in these conversations, but there is no clarity forthcoming, and that is deeply concerning and deeply worrying. And I don't know whether or not my official Richard wishes to add to that, because he's obviously involved, as you'd imagine, at official level discussions with finance colleagues.
Yeah, just a couple of things to add on the 22-23 position and where we're going into next year. So as the budget sets out, there aren't any formal consequentials that have been agreed for next year or for COVID-19. I think there are probably two critical points, though. One would be clearly in the money that we have agreed for the health portfolio, there are a number of things that we're taking forward to respond to the pandemic. So, you know, the money that we've invested in waiting times improvement, that's a direct consequence of the pandemic and investing that as well as we can. The money that we've put towards social care, that's designed to support the overall system in partly in view of the pandemic. It has a longer term impact as well. So we're doing what's in our power and what's in our gift to make those decisions now. I think the point that the Cabinet Secretary makes about the kind of ongoing measures in relation to test and protect and vaccinations and PPE in particular, I think they're the key areas that we're working as closely as we can with both the Department of Health and Social Care and Treasury on, because they're the areas where we're likely to continue to need quite significant spend and where the clarity at this stage is not quite there. Some of that is understandable because, you know, we don't know what the future is going to hold, but I think they're the areas where the certainty is probably most greatly needed.
Thank you for that. And obviously, colleagues will dig into this further. In particular, as I said, Gillian Mackay has got questions around COVID-19. Just in terms of our scrutiny, obviously, the Programme for Government sets out those longer term spending commitments, but there's no medium term framework in place. I guess it's understandable. We're dealing with a very acute situation. But in terms of just giving us some information as to, our scrutiny, is there going to be more evidence coming forward about informing decisions and the allocation of increasing budgets? I mean, we obviously want to keep our eye on things like, you know, the 2.5 billion that's been promised over the course of the Parliament and the balance of care in terms of frontline health spending of 50%, and that increased for primary care by 25%. So can you give us any idea of sort of medium term plans?
Yeah, look, I think it's a very fair question, Convener. So I suppose, as we've already recognised, the health and social care medium term financial framework will have to be updated in light of COVID and other significant changes, such as our work towards a national care service. So the framework itself considers available resource demands, but what it doesn't do is obviously sets our budget. Our budget's informed by those key policy priorities, by the national performance framework, and to ensure that those commitments are linked budgets ultimately contribute towards the delivery of those desired outcomes. But there was a recent study done by the LSE and the Lancet suggests a 4% real terms growth in healthcare costs is to be expected to ensure improving quality of care and terms and conditions for health and care workforce. So that's very much in keeping with the assumptions underpinning the current medium-term financial framework. And of course, this, as well as other independent research, will no doubt inform our view, but there's no doubt at all that given the pressures and the challenges of COVID, we're going to have to look at that medium-term framework once again.
Okay, thank you. I've got a supplementary question on this from Sue Webber.
Thanks, Convener. Yes, Cabinet Secretary, you spoke a bit about the lack of transparency and you also mentioned silly political games. So I'm just wondering how you would then tackle something that's come from our own auditors. Audit Scotland has called for greater transparency, in particular around the COVID spending, and that the Scottish Government needs to have a more proactive approach in showing where and how this money has been spent. And I suppose that also related to the underspend of £292 million in the health and sport budget. And we've also heard on response to that from both SNP members in Westminster and also your finance secretary that the money has been carried forward. So I was just a little bit concerned, you know, in terms of that transparency when it comes to COVID spending, that we only see one line and it's not broken down into any sort of level of categories at all for last year, and then that subsequent carry forward isn't apparent anywhere in any of either table one or table two that I'm looking at today. I'm just wondering where that carry forward money is sitting in the budget that we're looking at today.
Yeah, so we'll give you detail of that, and look, we'll always look at any Audit Scotland report in great amount of detail and give consideration to the findings. You may have seen that Finance Secretary addressed some of the issues in the Audit Scotland report, and it was important to say that on resource, it was very well documented last year that very late consequentials in the last few months of the year would have to be carried forward to ensure vital programmes could continue, such as vaccinations. Vaccinations don't stop at the end of a financial year, for example. So we've got a budget for the full initiative. On capital, there's no doubt that lockdown had an impact on projects being able to be completed in the timescales that they had. In terms of our own portfolio, probably the most, one of the most affected, as well as transport and infrastructure. You know, contrary to any claims, the economy budget was overspent. I think it's important to digest the full detail of what was in that Audit Scotland report. Indeed, in terms of transparency around the budget, I'm always happy to take any consideration that members may have about how we can be even more transparent than we currently are. On that, I'll perhaps bring in Richard McCallum, who may have more details. If there's any specifics, of course, that Ms Webber wants to know about, she can come back in response after perhaps Richard is able to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, I think as the Cabinet Secretary said, you know, in terms of the information that we provide to Audit Scotland and others, you know, I would certainly want to be as clear as we can in terms of not just all the COVID monies that we've spent, but our whole portfolio. And I mean, I am in regular engagement with Audit Scotland every month to update them on our financial plans and talk them through our position, and would continue to do that. And I think as a general point for this committee, if there's more information that is required on either specific funding lines or the general budget position, then we'd absolutely want to provide that information. In terms of the specific point about the underspend at the end of 2020-21, So as you say, it was 292 million for the portfolio, and that really does relate to two things. As the Cabinet Secretary said, the first thing was just the timing of consequentials. So we got some confirmation of funding in January of 2021. And just in terms of time to actually use that as well and as efficiently as possible, it meant bringing that into the new financial year. So that was the bulk of that. The second aspect, and it's a bit more technical, but it was in relation to PPE. And we agreed an approach with Treasury that we would, for Treasury purposes, that we would account for that on cost. But for the purposes of the Scottish Parliament budget, we showed that by way of stock held. It's a bit of a technical accounting thing, so I can provide more information if needed, but that kind of increased the underspend as a result. But it was something that we did in agreement and alignment with Treasury on that. And I suppose just the final point, because that money was then carried into 21-22, that's why it's not showing on the face of the 22-23 budget, because it carried into the current financial year rather than the future financial year, which is what the budget's looking at.
Thank you. Now we're going to health board budgets, and we've got Sandesh Gohani. Sandesh.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. NHS Eshe and Aran overspent on previous budgets, as have a number of different health boards. In particular with NHS Eshe and Aran, there's also looking like there's it requires significant transformational change, particularly in acute services. And that to me is a bit of a worry given where we are at the moment. So my first question is, will you be writing off the overspends on budgets previously with the other health boards? And the second question is really looking at NHS Eshe and Aran with the significant transitional changes that are required and what is being done about that.
So can I thank Sandesh Gohani for his questions on Eshe and Aran. I'm certain he's no doubt aware of this. But of course, they remain at level three on the escalation framework, of course, which is a very serious position for them to be in. And that is very specifically in relation to the financial management. So we continue, as you'd imagine, in line with level three escalation, undertake support and scrutiny in line with that framework. So, of course, financial recovery remains a priority for these boards. The focus has been on the response to the pandemic, and that has undoubtedly impacted on their financial recovery plans. So you know, we keep in very regular dialogue with Ayrshire and Aran. As you can see in terms of the budget in front of you for 22-23, they are also in receipt of additional funding and finance, but we put some additional monitoring in place for those escalated boards. Ayrshire and Aran is one of them, there's another couple. To ensure that there's some steps, appropriate steps being taken in terms of cost improvement, in terms of efficiency in advance of 22-23. So, I mean, I remain concerned about Ayrshire and Aran, also about Borders and Highland, and Highland recently, of course, also subject to Section 22 in relation to finance as well. So, continue to have those concerns.
And Cabinet Secretary, would you be looking to write off a proportion of the debt that the health boards have accrued?
Again, and Richard may wish to come in and add more to this, but for me, we'll work closely with the boards in terms of how we can support them. We want them to get into a financially sustainable level. Governments, for example, writing off debts, whether it's for health boards or other boards, are always matters that we would, of course, consider, but it comes at a cost somewhere else within the health budget to be able to do that. And with every penny allocated, that becomes incredibly difficult. So we want Ayrshire and Aran, and Audit Scotland, I'm sure, would expect this, to be able to stand in their 2 feet, financially viable, and have in place those financial mechanisms and controls that can get them de-escalated from level three of the framework. But Richard, I don't know if you want to again add more detail to what I've said to Dr. Gohani.
Yeah, a couple of things, and I think, Dr. Gilhani, it's a really important question. I think over the course of the last 20 months, we've taken an approach with boards where we have needed to balance, you know, that ongoing financial management and financial scrutiny with the realities that the health boards have needed to focus on the immediates of dealing with a pandemic. And a transformation program doesn't just happen in a finance department. That needs to be hand in hand with clinicians, with those working in the service. And so there's an important balance that we need to strike between asking boards to continue with that good financial management and scrutiny and transformation change, but at the same time recognize the pressures that they're on in terms of dealing with the pandemic. With that in mind, we've taken an approach in the last in 2020, 21, and indeed the approach we'll take this year, where we won't be providing providing brokerage. We'll be supporting all boards with COVID funding, which will allow them to balance their financial position in this year, as all boards did last year. And we recognise there's an element of unachieved savings just because they haven't been able to move forward with their savings plans as they might normally have done pre-pandemic. I think, though, the point that the Cabinet Secretary raises about keeping those boards that were financially escalated under, if you like, enhanced measures. So we are getting monthly reporting from those boards, which shows what they're doing by way of their financial planning. And whilst the pandemic goes on, that transformation work hasn't stopped, and we've continued to discuss with the boards the steps that they've got in place. I think going beyond this, we've asked all boards for three-year plans, service plans and finance plans for 22, 23 and beyond, and that will tie in with the spending review when that comes in May. And I think that's when we'll be looking to get greater assurance and certainty about boards' financial plans moving forward.
Thank you. I have one further question, Convener. I was looking at through the details of the money that's been provided to the boards, and distinction awards have looked like they've come down. So my question is, are we still giving out new distinction awards, or has this been phased out?
No, I don't think we are giving distinction awards. But again, Richard, you might want to pick up on this. We took a decision not to, but Richard, again, you'll want to just provide clarity on that.
Yeah, that's correct. That's the right position, and that's why that money's reducing each year, because there's not new awards coming, and that budget line will probably continue to reduce because there's not new awards being provided.
It's been a number of years now that we've taken that decision. Sorry, on you go.
Absolutely. So in the more detailed table, it said that the distinction awards are designed to provide competitive remuneration packages for consultants and ensure we attract and retain the right calibre of employee. So without the distinction awards, how are we achieving this?
So there's a number of other ways that we can look to try to recruit and retain, and indeed under this government there's been a quite incredible increase in the number of medical consultants since 2006, which we're pleased about. But I take the point about retention. There's a number of avenues that we're looking at. One is, of course, to make sure that they're well remunerated. The other option we're looking at is pensions. Now, some of that is in our gift, but a lot of that is within the UK government's gift, and I've been having discussions with the UK government about potential pension changes. You probably know, I think you may be a member of the BMA, of course. The BMA have written to me to look at whether or not there's more that we could do from a Scottish government perspective on potential pension changes, which would help with retention. So, look, there's a number of other avenues that we can look to as opposed to distinction awards, which we haven't been providing now for a number of years. But I'll work closely with the BMA, with others, in order to make sure that Scotland isn't just a competitive place to recruit more consultants, but of course retain them, which is key to Dr. Gohani's question.
Thank you. I'm seeing that Sue Webber wants to come in. I'm just checking with Sue. I've got you leading on the theme of capital budgets. So if you've got a supplementary question on health boards, if you can just move on to your questions on capital budget after that. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. Yes, I suppose as representing NHS Lothian, I was again sort of disappointed at the distance from the NREC recommendations for NHS Lothian. 12 million. So, and you've also spoken about how, Richard mentioned this earlier, about how health, you're prioritising funding to health boards that are struggling to deal with the pandemic. And to be fair, I think most of them are to some degree. So when we see that the greatest percentages of increases are going to the national boards and not the local health boards, I'm just, yes, the waiting time centre's there and it's an elective planned service, but those, the ones that are really struggling are the ones that are struggling with A&E that have got the emergency admissions. So I'm just wondering what the decision was made around disproportionately giving more to the likes of Public Health Scotland, National Services Scotland, Health Improvement Scotland and the Waiting Time Centre rather than some of the health boards?
No, so look, every health board of course is receiving an uplift and that's important. And I completely accept, of course, Ms Webber, that you will want to go out there batting for Lothian, of course, why would you not, given the role that you have. But what I would say is that every single health board is of course facing significant challenge. The A&E departments at the ERI, for example, of course, are challenged when I look at the figures. But also if I went across the M8 to the figures to the A&E department in the Queen Elizabeth, or if I went to Forth Valley Hospital or the ARI in Grampian, you know, A&E departments right across the country are significantly under pressure and significantly suffering, and therefore our NRAC formula plus the parity funding that we then sometimes introduce to make sure the boards are within 0.8% of parity, that can assist health boards right across the country. What I would say is that the funding to other boards, the kind of non-territorial boards, is really vital. You referenced there the funding to Public Health Scotland. If you just think about how crucial they have been in our fight against the virus in the last 20 months, I don't think, and I'm certain you're not doing this, but nobody would argue take money away from Public Health Scotland and then decide to split it elsewhere. So all these boards are important, whether you're territorial or non-territorial. You know, we've got record investment in the health service, £18 billion, the first time we've ever been able to finance health and social care to that level. So significant amounts of funding. What I would say to Sue Webber is I can give an absolute promise and guarantee that I meet with Lothian on a very regular basis. And I have to say I've got a great amount of faith in the management team there and also the chair and the board to be able to put that money to good use to help to improve what is a very difficult situation right across Lothian.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, I've got a great admiration for NHS Lothian as well. You mentioned, in terms of the capital budget, you specifically mentioned the Baird and Anchor project and Parkhead and Social Health and Social Care Centre in Glasgow. Because in the past, I've always had it levelled at me that there's only perhaps not been the level of investment in building that new GP infrastructure across the country, and you might get one significant GP practice funded in any government term. So, will more detail on how that might manifest come in the if the capital investment strategy plan is published, and when might we see that?
Yeah, I think it's a good question to ask, and yeah, as you can see from our funding, the Baird Family Hospital and the Anchor Cancer Centre, we will invest significant amounts of money and that more than £120 million, which is important. You'll also see from that capital funding, you know, a significant amount of funding, more than £30 million in a year for Parkhead, which is actually our biggest investment in health and social care centre. And I think that is the model we want to try to move forward with where it works. And it's not appropriate everywhere, but certainly in those health and social care centres, we know we can get the appropriate support in one place for the public that we serve, and they can be exceptionally helpful, particularly, again, the point that Sue Webber was making before, particularly to try to reduce that demand at the front door in our acute sites, which is going to be really important. So a couple of things, of course, in addition to that, we have committed through our manifesto to spend £10 billion on health infrastructure over the next 10 years. And that's a really ambitious target, and so we're going to have to make sure we profile that appropriately over the space of the decade. In terms of the specific question she asked about the capital investment strategy, you're absolutely right that is going to be key to some of these important funding decisions. We had intended to publish it after the Infrastructure Commission for Scotland published their report, and that was on the 20th of January 2020, however, of course, but we've all been focused on the response to the pandemic. So we don't have a date to absolutely nail down, but I can promise her that the strategy will be published as soon as it possibly can be, because Ms Webber's right, it's an important document that's going to give people at least some comfort and reassurance that these important capital projects have been taken forward.
Thanks. Again, on the £10 billion, when you've said, Cabinet Secretary, about refurbishing health infrastructure, can I ask, does that include technology that's within the hospital infrastructure specifically? So we're talking about capitals, whether it be theatre tables, new theatres, buying newer and better capital. And I just, I suppose, with an experience that I was aware of, you know, in Glasgow specifically, you know, the hospital wasn't able to buy a new theatre table or certain pieces of equipment, but it was able to lease it at £2,000 a time, which didn't make much sense to me when you look at the number of times they were looking to rent something versus the overall spend. So I'm just trying to gauge what might be able, because I know the level of capital that's getting down to that granular level isn't always significant enough to invest in what's actually needed for services.
Yeah, so we haven't made any final decisions on how that money will be earmarked yet. So we haven't given full detail of that. Obviously, you know, we'd have to look at what the health board wanted to fund and whether it could be financed through capital or whether it could be financed through resource. So if there are kind of specific examples, and I suppose you mentioned a theatre table there. I mean, our capital projects, of course, these are important investments to make, and we need to give health boards the ability to make sure they're renewing their equipment where possible. But of course, the real focus on our capital infrastructure programme will be on significant refurbishment and significant replacement and build of assets. But Richard, I don't know if you wish to come in on the specifics around theatre tables being.
Just an example of theatre table, Cabinet Secretary.
No, I know. I think the point you're making is important. I'm genuinely not just focused on the big projects, but there's a question there about some of the smaller bend.
Richard.
Yeah, I think it is a really important point. One specific example, but what I would say is, as part of that, the capital strategy that we'd look to bring forward, that will include an equipment replacement programme. Because we know that that's a challenge and a risk for health boards to make sure that boards are working forward with a clear plan and design for those things. So we've worked actually with all the territorial boards over the course of the last year to look at their equipment replacement plans, and we've built that into to the workings that we've done as part of the capital investment strategy.
Thank you. Can I bring in Paul Kane has a supplementary question, Paul?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. I think just following on from that point about that £10 billion investment over the next decade, you know, given that health capital budgets are typically around £500 million, it's clear that there's going to have to be quite a detailed uprating of that budget, essentially. So I'm keen to understand where the Cabinet Secretary thinks that will come from. And within that, there have been a huge amount of capital promises made, whether in the plan that's not yet published or indeed in the manifesto. So, for example, in my own region, refurbishment of the RAH, I think, refurbishment of Vale of Leven Hospital. We know that there's a £76 million repair backlog already at the RAH. So I'm just keen to understand how and when we're profiling these things.
Yeah, it's a very fair question. And I suppose some of it goes back to what I said to Webber. So given the capital infrastructure projects that we have, that we currently are dealing with, for example, you know, the biggest one that is in my entry at the moment is the replacement of Monklands. We suspect most of that money is going to be, I suppose, backloaded to the latter years of that 10-year spend. But that is why I appreciate the capital infrastructure strategy, the capital investment strategy, forgive me, for health is published sooner rather than later. So given what I've said to Ms. Weber already, I probably don't have much to add other than to say, I hope for understandable reasons, people understand why that was delayed, but I also accept their challenge back, which is they need, as elected members, some certainty. So I can give them a guarantee that we're working on the investment strategy and that we aim to publish it as soon as possible.
Thank you. We'll move on to questions specifically around COVID-19 health spending, and Gillian Mackay. Gillian.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Given the new variant, have estimates and identified funding allocation changed 2022-23 budget?
It's a developing situation, and undoubtedly well, and I suppose it goes back to my initial remarks to the Convener, which is, you know, we're perplexed by the level of COVID consequentials and COVID funding that UK government has put on the table. And it may be that that's their kind of initial estimate, but then they'll add to that as circumstances dictate. But for us, it's deeply concerning, and the Omicron variant, without a shadow of a doubt, adds financial pressure. So Dilly Mackay is very aware, because I've heard her speak in the chamber on this, that of course, with additional resource, we could potentially go further in terms of measures to take and compensate business who are already suffering, even with the guidance and the advice and the regulations that are currently in place. They're getting cancellations by the thousands, and that is a serious financial impact that comes with that. So there's no doubt that Omicron, and if there is to be another variant, of course, which we cannot discount, then that is going to add even more financial pressure, and therefore that clarity is much needed.
Obviously, we've already spoken about the lack of clarity on additional funding coming from the UK government. If there was additional funding to come, how would you envisage that being diverted to different parts of the health service?
So again, I think part of it would be to give more financial compensation to those sectors that have been hit and hit hard. And again, I won't preempt what the First Minister has to say in the next couple of hours. But it'd be fair to say, even as the position is at the moment, there's no doubt that not only has the hospitality sector been hit hard, but the event sector, for example, has been hit hard. The cultural sector has been hit hard, and so on and so forth. So if we had some greater financial certainty, then we would be able to act in a way that we thought was in the best interests of Scotland. And, you know, again, that's not just a kind of SNP Scottish Government position. The Welsh Government have said similar, but they're of course in a different political party, where actually the decisions that are appropriate to make for our country shouldn't be constrained about whether or not we get additional resource from the UK Government. It should be that we take the decisions that are the best interests of health in Scotland, and then the funding flows from the Treasury in respect of those decisions. Of course, bolstering, continuing to bolster Test and Protect and the vaccination programme as key foundation blocks in our fight against this virus are always important. They are being adequately funded. But we had to push, just one example, I mean, we had to push the UK government really, really hard in order for them to extend the contract for the Glasgow Lighthouse Lab, which has done an incredible job. But the contract was due to run out in March 2022, and people, we were all getting anecdotal evidence that people were already potentially going to be looking for other jobs if they had no job security. Now, the UK government have now moved on that and extended the contract to September 2022, but it shouldn't take us to have to keep pushing them in order to do that, to get that level of certainty.
And just finally, Convener, given the emergence of the Omicron variant and obviously the impact that will have on the recovery of the health service, how do you see that spending around recovery being allocated now that we do have the new variant and the uncertainty around that?
Well, just no doubt it causes more difficulty. You know, the emergence of a new variant that is more transmissible means that we are facing even greater challenge, because you know, when Omicron first emerged, and the member will of course know this, when the first clusters were found in around the Lanarkshire area, you know, we ended up in a position where entire departments in our acute sites in Lanarkshire were worried about staffing levels. Now they've been able to cope, and I pay a tribute to the management at Lanarkshire and the Health Board at Lanarkshire being able to manage that situation, but it looked really difficult and challenging at one period in time. So the emergence of a new variant doesn't just have direct health impacts, which of course it does, and we have to factor that into the recovery, but it affects our staff. Now, there's now an exemption, as you know, process in place for NHS and social care staff, but still, if you are a positive, if you are a positive case yourself, and those positive cases are increasing, as you can see from the daily numbers of recent, then that's clearly still going to have an impact on the health service.
Thank you. Thanks, Gillian. If I can move on to Paul Kane's got some questions on social care and national care service. Paul.
Thank you, convener. Just to really try and get a handle on the figures, I think, within the text of the budget, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could explain the difference between 1.6 billion figure, which is highlighted in the budget, and the 1.1 billion figure that's identified in the budget tables, which comes under social care investment. I'm just trying to understand the difference in terms of those two figures and what, you know, is the actual spend.
Yeah, let me just look at the tables as you're talking. Yeah, okay, so I mean, the in-year, I think the explanation for that would be that the in-year transfers from the health portfolio to local government, they're grouped together within the budget as a kind of quote unquote social care investment. The detailed elements are then set out within the level four budget tables, which are available on the Scottish Government website. And this is the total of the 1.1 billion. However, 1.6 billion, that's the overall package of investment in social care and integration. So that comes from a combination of funding that has been baselined in health boards and local government, and also from further in-year transfers from the health portfolio to local government. So that's why there's a bit of perhaps seemingly discrepancy between the figures. But perhaps we can make that a little bit more clear. That's my reading of it. Richard, is there anything in there that you want to add?
If broadcasting, can just unmute Richard. Thank you.
Yep, I think that's that's correct, Cabinet Secretary. So the 1.6 represents all the money that's passed from the health and social care portfolio to social care. About 500 million of that has either already been baselined in local government settlements or is part of an NHS board settlement that will pass through to IJBs. The 1.1 billion represents the transfer that will go across in year. So that's the difference between those two numbers.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, convener. I think it would be useful just in terms of our scrutiny if we can have some of that further detail perhaps written for committee, just to take that forward. I wonder if I can, convener, just ask essentially about the structure of the National Care Service, and whilst we're obviously still going through those responses, and we don't yet have the structure finalised, there's of course the proposal to create community health and social care boards to essentially replace IJBs. So I'm keen to understand if the Cabinet Secretary thinks that many of the issues that have been experienced with financial accountability and leadership in IJBs will be solved by creating a new structure.
So I think it's a really good question. I mean, the first thing I would say is that there's no fait accompli here. Nobody, I think I've said this before to the committee, and I'm not sitting here with a master plan of what the National Care Service will look like, and then expecting the consultation process to just fit in with what my thoughts are. Far from it. We are really genuinely interested in the analysis of the responses we've received. We've received quite a number of responses. I'm also genuinely very considerate of making sure that we don't create the system and then try to fit the people into it, but instead, make sure our system fits around the individuals. And financial accountability is hugely important for us as decision makers and policy makers, but hugely important for the individuals. I will not be the only MSP who has had to fight on behalf of a constituent because they haven't received the package of care for a loved one or a relative. And their fear is that the reason for that has been more to do with cost and finances than to do with the actual needs of the individual. So my hope is that the structure that we end up putting in place, and again, I just emphasise and re-emphasise what I've said, that nothing is concluded yet on that. But you know, if we go down the model of the creation of community health and social care boards, then absolutely financial accountability and, I think Paul Kane said, leadership, you know, those two issues have got to be central to the creation of a national care service, whatever structure we end up putting in place.
Thank you. Paul, have you got one more question or can I move on?
Yeah, I do just have one more. If I can just perhaps segue into the subject of pay for social care workers. The Cabinet Secretary for Finance in the budget process said that she felt that the kind of 48p increase was fair and you know, pays carers for their labours, I think was the expression. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with that? Does he feel that that's acceptable pay in terms of the pay increase for care workers?
What I would say to Paul Kane is that you know, I know he uses the 48 pence figure, and I appreciate if I was in his position, I might end up doing the same. But of course, if you look at what that pay increase means for an adult social care worker over the course of a year, then that's not something to be scoffed at. We're talking about almost an additional, just shy of an additional £1,000 a year. Now, that's not the only pay increase that we have brought forward, and I have brought forward as Cabinet Secretary for Health. Of course, that comes on top of an additional pay uplift from £9.50 to £10.02, and then, of course, increasing that to £10.50. What I would say to Paul O'Kane is that as we continue to be within this budget process, if he believes that social care funding should increase, for example, to £12 or to £15 an hour, I'm not sure what the current position necessarily is, but we would have to find that, of course, within the budget, which is allocated, and they don't come cheaply. You know, you've called, I know in the chamber before, for £12 per hour, an increase to £12 per hour. That would cost £420 million per annum, or £1.3 billion if we took it to the £15 per hour. Even more actually, once improvements to terms and conditions are factored in, it could be up to £1.6 billion. So these are not small numbers at all. I absolutely take the point that our social care colleagues and adult social care in particular need to be recognised and valued. And that's why we've ensured that they get a pay increase and a pay uplift. But any addition to that, of course, let's have that discussion. But let's be upfront about where that money would come from.
Right, we will move on to preventative spend and questions from Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. It's good to see a focus on preventative spend in this budget. How is the Scottish Government ensuring there is a joined-up approach to spending and outcomes across other portfolio areas?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is probably the most crucial question that we could deal with at the moment, because the preventative spend agenda is something that we have progressed as a government for a number of years, and it was something that was core to Christie, which is as relevant today as it was when the Christie Commission was published. And therefore, for us, we can do everything we want in health, but if we operate as a silo, then we're not going to make the difference in people's lives that we would want to do. So we've got to make sure we're working with our colleagues, which we are, in education, across social justice, justice itself as a portfolio, housing, the economy, and therefore the work that the DFM does, where he brings us together on at least a weekly basis, with our focus, really laser focus on, for example, targets around child poverty, then that is helping us to work in a way that is even more collegiate than it has been previously, and I have to say it's going to help not just us as decision makers, but I don't doubt it's going to have a really important effect and outcome on those that perhaps have you know, very regrettably fallen through the cracks in the various systems that they get passed from pillar to post to, and that's just not acceptable. So, you know, I think there's good joined up working taking place between various different portfolios.
Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. And we've heard about all the pressures on the NHS, and obviously we're in the midst of another wave of COVID again. How can funding for preventative spend measures be protected?
I think the two are linked, in all honesty. I think you know, you can again help people through COVID with the various spends that we have already put into the budget, but actually, you know, if they get their vaccine, take vaccinations as an example, you know, we know from the data that we've seen that those, for example, in the most deprived areas, we know that the uptake can be the lowest in terms of the vaccine. So actually, when we deal with preventative spend, when we focus in on child poverty and early intervention, then actually that can even help us in our vaccination efforts in the future. Not just for this current pandemic, but we've got to be prepared for what the next pandemic might well be. And so it's really, really important for us to not see the two as being distinct or separate, which I know, of course, you absolutely don't. In terms of just protection, I think it'd be fair to say if you looked at our budget in detail, it delivers on that 50% of frontline spend being directed towards community health services, and progresses our commitment to increase primary care funding by 25%. So, you know, we've got a good basis to build upon, but absolutely, you know, these are difficult balances to get right in terms of the current pressures versus what is seen as preventative. But I try not to look at them as completely distinct, separate, but actually, you know, our investment in preventative will help us in relation to dealing with the pandemic as well.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener.
Right, thank you, Evelyn. And moving on to talking about shifting the balance of spend, we've got questions from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. We've taken evidence in previous health committees about shifting the balance of care and moving spend to be more, I suppose, preventative and away from hospital settings and more in the community. And the Scottish Government has committed to shifting the balance of care so that at least 50% of frontline health spending takes place in community health services. So, given that this is in the budget, would the Cabinet Secretary think that this maybe needs to be more ambitious, or is 50% adequate for how we're planning right now?
I do like that question from Emma Harper. It's a fair one to ask. You know, are we, you know, if we're already getting there, then are we challenging ourselves enough? So I mean, I think it's a very kind of fair gauntlet to throw down. So for me, first of all, it's a positive that we've got to where we've got to. The purpose, of course, of the target is really to underline, well, to make changes on the ground, of course, but to underline the Scottish Government's focus on shifting the balance of care where this is possible, but also ensuring that we've got appropriate support for hospital-based services. Nobody at all that would be saying that, you know, we'd be... those are resources, which is an important point. I know that, of course, Emma Harper, given her own personal experience, understands very well. So we'll continue to review the appropriate portion of the spend. And I suppose going back to what I said previously to the convener, perhaps we'll take that into account when we get further details. Once we do some further work on the medium term financial framework. But I think in general, Emma Harper's challenge to us is a fair one. If we're already meeting that target, then should we be looking to be even more ambitious? So it's something I'll absolutely reflect on.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I mean, I know sometimes, you know, we have all these budget lines and top lines and different, you know, figures are just thrown out there. And I am interested in the, you know, the £15 per hour for care care persons, because that's what the Band 5 three-year university-trained staff nurse makes. So if we were going to challenge to move that spend or increase the spend, that then puts then another burden on workforce planning as well. So that would be a concern for me. I'm suggesting that, well, our social care staff should be supported and educated to have clinical expertise and progression. But the 1.6 billion is an interesting figure that you've given us if that was to be the case for a £15 salary. I suppose that would be an interesting just to hear your additional comments on that.
Well, there's nothing much to add other than every single person around this the committee virtual table is in the same space when it comes to all of us valuing the role that social care workers have played throughout the course of this pandemic. And dare I say it, it should not have taken a pandemic for people to realise just what a significant and important role our social care workers play. Saying that is one thing, rewarding them appropriately is another. And I think in government we've got a good track record. As I say, in this, in the last 12 months we've increased their pay from effectively £9.50 to £10.50. And we've made sure that we're putting up the appropriate finance and funding for that. Now, I fully appreciate that there are members across the political parties who will say, we want you to go further. And that's why, if that is the case, then obviously engage in those budget discussions with the finance secretary, but you've got to be able to tell us where you take that money from. So do we take it from other parts of the health service, other parts of social care? But Emma Harper's right, of course, it could have a knock-on impact, of course, to other parts of the workforce, which we would have to factor in as well. So look, I am always up for this conversation on what more we can do to reward our social care staff. As I say, let's just do that based on figures. Let's do that based on what is available within the budget. And let's have a realistic conversation about where that money would have to be taken from if other parties want us to go even further.
Emma, thanks. Are you continuing to let me move on to mental health? Thank you.
I had one question just about the progress towards increasing the primary care spend by 25%. I think the government has a commitment to increase primary care spend by 25%. I'll make that my final question, convener.
Yes, we do. We are, and again, I was just looking at my tables, we are about 6%. So it's a good first step in that direction. So yes, you're right. We have that commitment. I'd be confident of meeting it. And this is a good step in the right direction.
Thank you. We can now move on to mental health spending. Questions from Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, not afternoon quite yet, Cabinet Secretary. Can I also just very quickly praise NHS Lanarkshire for all their hard work as well. Moving on to mental health, I appreciate that with NHS boards and integration joint boards often delivering mental health services, the tracking spending can be a wee bit challenging, particularly around things that are out with the health sector itself there. So a couple of questions on that. What evidence is being gathered to understand the impact and the effectiveness of the additional spend? And secondly, how does this influence the future funding decisions? For example, the balance between adult services and child and adolescent mental health services?
I mean, both really good questions and intrinsically linked. So I would agree with your opening remarks, or Stephanie Gallagher's opening remarks around the job that NHS Lanarkshire have done. They've not been without their challenges, and there's a number of challenges NHS Lanarkshire often faces, sometimes given its geography, but also given the pressures that it's under, and it's coped admirably well. And just to say, we're working, as you can imagine, on a very regular basis with NHS Lanarkshire to try to see where we can get them de-escalated from the highest level of escalation they're under at the moment. In terms of the specifics that you ask around, I think that's a really good point about the effectiveness of the interventions and of the money that we spend. So any funding that we allocate is delivered against really clear criteria. Those who are in receipt of that funding, they have to report on the impact of that funding and the outcomes that we agree on. But we also engage with stakeholders on a very regular and ongoing basis around the use of resources to deliver outcomes and what the risks may be, because there can be unforeseen risks that can't be accounted for in a funding application when it's received. We have, I think as a member probably knows, we've committed to refresh our long-term mental health strategy, and that work will actually build on the evidence of success that we've seen from interventions and also from engagement with stakeholders and I think quite crucially from those with lived experience to identify what the future priorities will be, and that of course in turn then helps us with what our funding priorities should be. I think the second part of the question from Stephanie Callaghan, which is a really good one again, is that balance between adult and kind of child adolescent services. And I suppose the first thing to say is, my goodness, what impact the pandemic will have had on all of that, on adult and indeed children and adolescent services. Now, that's not to say there wasn't challenges before. I readily accept that there was challenges before. I would not, again, have been the only MSP on this call who would have had a constituent who was in need, and the waiting lists and waiting times for CAMHS was far too long, and I'm not going to pretend otherwise, but there's no doubt that that's been exacerbated by the pandemic. Our mental health transition and recovery plan that was published in October last year, that reviewed those priorities and decisions on the use of an additional £120 million recovery and renewal fund allocated to support the delivery of that plan, based very much on an assessment of proposals that were set against those priorities. But they were very much in discussions with key stakeholders. These are difficult decisions to get right in terms of that balance between adult and child and adolescent services, but it's something that we're continually looking at, and it's part of our recovery plan, NHS recovery plan, ambitions going forward to make sure we get that balance absolutely right, but it's going to require significant investment going forward.
That's great, thanks. So kind of following on from that again, I suppose, during the evidence session that we had on perinatal mental health, we did hear evidence from mums as well talking about the critical role that third sector organisations were performing locally. And their expertise and support was an absolute lifeline as far as mums were concerned. And in that session too, we heard from third sector stakeholders too, who were really expressing quite a bit of concern around the fact they were losing a bit of their local specialism and expertise there, that really makes a positive impact on the ground and local mental health services. So my question there is, How can we have more secure, long-term third sector funding? How can that be provided to support the mental health delivery by third sector organisations actually in the community settings?
Yeah. Look, I again concur with everything Stephanie Callaghan is saying. As you'd imagine, from a local MSP's perspective, let alone health secretary perspective, see the value on the ground every day of the third sector organisations and partners Ms. Callaghan refers to. From my perspective, I want to make it absolutely clear as Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care that we don't just value third sector organisations through our words alone, but through our deeds. And our 22-23 mental health budget will increase by 6% on the 21-22 figure. And this year, we've allocated a greater proportion to support community and third sector projects, including £15 million for grassroots community groups via a community's mental health and wellbeing fund for adults to help tackle the impact of social isolation, loneliness, and mental health inequalities. In terms of certainty for the future, I don't doubt one of the asks that I get is an ask that every single member here gets, which is for that multi-year budget, and of course, the Finance Secretary has laid out some of the groundwork about how she would look to potentially do that for future years. And that might provide that longer term sustainable funding and outlook for third sector organisations in the future. We're not at that stage yet, but certainly I know it's an ambition that we have in government.
Thank you, Stephanie. Can I move on to talking about alcohol and drug services? Questions from Sue Webber.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I did mention earlier about the Audit Scotland report saying that the Scottish Government needs to be more proactive in showing where and how this money has been spent, in a generic sort of budgeting part. So I'm looking for support and commitment that in terms of the importance that we're all giving to tackling our drug-related deaths, can the Scottish Government now commit to really publishing regular information that shows us the granular detail on how this money is being spent?
In principle, I'd have no issues with that, and I can again look at what we're publishing at the moment and whether or not that would meet your expectations, and we can have a discussion around that. In my letter to the committee, I did reference in some level of detail ADP income and spending for 2021. We intend to publish this information once the analysis is complete. We'll provide the publication to the committee, of course, and we'll do that. This will provide a level of detail on the income and spending of alcohol and drug services locally and what is provided in addition to the Scottish Government. But if you looked at that and you thought it did not provide you with the level of detail you were expecting, then I'm very open to having a further conversation about how we can provide that.
Well, so we're just looking to get that sense of consistency across the country, which is a theme we get from all our committees and just the variances that happen. So in the budget, there's an extra 1.2 million increase in the direct Scottish Government spending on the alcohol and drug policy. But how does that relate, and how does that come together with the commitment for the additional 50 million per year for the lifetime of the Parliament? I'm just trying to get a sense of what the relation is. Maybe Richard might be better.
Yeah. I'm more than happy to bring Richard in a second, but it's fair to say it's just to be absolutely clear, it's in addition to that. So this funding is in addition to the 61 million reducing drugs deaths budget, which includes the second tranche of £50 million of additional funding as part of the 250 commitment, which is over, obviously, as you know, over 5 years from 21-22. So that funding is specifically aimed at supporting additional response to our collective challenge around drugs death. Our increase of 1.2 million, which you reference on alcohol and drugs funding for 22-23, brings total budget to 24.4 million, and that includes investment in alcohol harm and treatment policy team to deliver our alcohol priorities from Alcohol Focus Scotland, Scottish Health Action on alcohol problems, and the Scottish Alcohol Counselling Consortium, and also provides funding for very specific alcohol services that'll be able to be delivered to support the Simon community, deliver a pilot managed alcohol programme. So this funding is an addition to the £61 million reducing drugs death budget. But I hope that's clear. But I don't know, Richard, if you have anything to add to that.
No, I think you've covered it. Okay. The 250 million over the Parliament, this is the second year of that, 50 million each year, and that's covered in the 22-23 budget.
Yeah. So, thank you. And finally, it is, as I said earlier, we're all across the chamber, every party's tackling this, and we really want to make sure that additional funding is breaking through and it's getting down to where it needs to. So how will the additional spending be targeted to ensure it's being used effectively in that way? And again, how are we going to measure that impact, and what are we looking at to make sure that the money that we are investing is having the desired impact and saving lives?
Yeah, look, there's a slew of statistics that are published very regularly, which I know Ms. Webber will keep a very close eye on, as we do too, which will demonstrate whether or not we're making progress in this area that we all want to see progress in. But monitoring and evaluation will be very much at the heart of what we do. The Scottish Government works closely with our Alcohol and Drugs Partnerships to monitor the delivery of the national mission, and this is a national mission, and any organisation which receives funding for drug services will always provide regular reports on their outcome. But we'll also work with those public bodies that are really vital to this, Public Health Scotland, Healthcare Improvement Scotland, to understand what the bigger picture is in terms of delivery. So the local interventions, absolutely, getting in amongst that at a local level is going to be really important. My officials do that, but making sure we keep an eye on the bigger picture. And of course, we'll use that data to inform future funding decisions too. But look, we are quite rightly going to be held to account on this money, how it is spent and what difference it's making. And I would expect Ms Weber, she will do anyway, and indeed all parliamentarians, to make sure the government is using that money in the most effective way possible, given the nature of the crisis we're dealing with.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Sue. Can I move on to questioning around sport and active living from Emma Harper? Emma.
Thanks, Convener. I'm pleased to be asking about sport and active living. We know how getting out and getting a daily mile or getting a walk during the first lockdown was really, really important for people, including for their mental health. And in the budget, there's a proposal that the investment is doubling to £100 million by the end of the Parliament for sport and active living, and which I think is really good news. So how will the additional funding for sport and active living be prioritised, Cabinet Secretary?
Thanks to Ms Harper for the question. You're right, it's an important commitment. I think it's become, again, even more important given what we've been dealing with in the pandemic. And again, we know how sport is not just good for physical health, of course it is that, but also so good for mental health as well. So really important that we live up to that commitment, which we of course intend to do, that £100 million, doubling our investment to £100 million a year by the end of the Parliament. So how will it be spent? It allows us to rebuild capacity and resilience in the sector following closures during the pandemic. We can't be unaware of the impact that the pandemic has had on sports. Now that can be at a local grassroots level, your daughter's football club that she goes to on a Saturday, being hit hard with the pandemic, don't have reserves to be able to reach into, the right way through to the biggest clubs in the country. And of course, not just across one sport, but right across the myriad of sports that we have, and how they've been affected because of the lack of people coming through the turnstiles, for example. And I again don't and won't preempt anything the FM will say this afternoon, but clearly Omicron is giving us a great degree of concern in that respect too. So we'll work closely with Sport Scotland and partners to understand how we can best increase that investment in physical activity and sport, while ensuring that we also address the issues around inequality. And some sports, frankly, have done better at dealing with that issue around the inequality of access. But I think there's some sports and some sporting bodies that perhaps have a little bit more work to do in that respect.
Okay. Just a quick question on social prescribing. We've heard, and we have had previous we did a previous report in the last session about the benefits of social prescribing, that it's an investment, not a cost. And so we know social prescribing is good for physical and mental health as well. So I'm interested in what needs to be done or what is being done to demonstrate that social prescribing is really good. And then how will that work help evidence that maybe social prescribing could benefit from further investment?
So I'm a great believer in social prescribing, as is the government, and I can certainly look at what we're publishing in terms of evidence and evaluation around that, and I'll certainly take that one off table and provide you with more information. But of course, our programme for government does include a commitment that by 2026, every single GP practice will have access to a mental health and wellbeing service. And that will fund 1,000 additional dedicated staff who can help grow community mental health resilience and direct social prescribing. And I think for me, that will make a massive difference in relation to the access to social prescribing. I know from the community link worker that I have in my own constituency, who does an incredible job reaching into third sector, reaching into other support organisations, and helping with that social prescribing has made a big, big difference to a number of my constituents. So I'll look at what we are publishing or what we have published in terms of evaluation on that, and I'll come back to the committee via the convener. But on the general point that Ms Harper makes, I agree in with it in its entirety.
Can I bring in Sandresh Gohani, who's got a quick supplementary on this?
Thank you, convener. Kin Atkinson of Scottish Sports Association gave us evidence to say that culture is free. Why is sport not free? So my question is, do you accept the cost of facilities can be a major barrier to participation? And hoping that you do accept that, what measures can be put into place to address this?
Dr. Gohani is right. I do absolutely accept it. It's why I alluded to the fact in my previous answer that there are some sports I think have done well in making their sport more accessible, but I think there are other sports and sporting bodies that have still got some work to do. So we have, as we say, in the 2022-23 budget, increased our funding for sport and to support Active Scotland's key outcomes in terms of encouraging physical activity, developing physical confidence from an early age, etc., etc. But we're working very closely with Sport Scotland to make sure that they support clubs and communities to offer a range of opportunities for young people in particular to participate through community sports hubs. Be making sure that we're doing as much as we possibly can to work through schools as well. We're doing what we can in and around, for example, when it comes to cycling. If I take that as just one example, making that more accessible by providing bikes where we can to those who are not able to afford them, and making sure that they're available in community hubs as well. So I'm happy to provide more detail where I can, but it's effective. I agree with the premise. Absolutely, and I think there's other areas where probably we need to fund. I mean, cycling facilities fund is one example. There was another example actually. We worked well with the Robertson Trust, which I think many members will probably know, and their Spirit of 2021 and Sport Scotland. We worked with them to deliver Changing Lives through Sport and Physical Activity Fund. And that provided direct resource into sporting and community sectors to address those wider access issues. It directly funded 17 collaborative partnerships between sporting and non-sporting organisations to deliver sport and physical activity within their communities, and again with a real focus on accessibility. But the wider point that Dr. Gohani makes is one that I'm entirely in agreement with.
Thank you, colleagues. I'm sorry to curtail the sport questioning, but we only have 10 minutes left and we have two members who haven't asked questions yet. Can I move on to talking about health inequalities and questions from Carol Mochan? Carol.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Tackling inequality and poverty, I believe, is absolutely what we as MSPs are here to do, and it's across every portfolio. Cabinet Secretary, in our evidence sessions, we have heard from experts almost in every session that to tackle health inequalities, we have to tackle poverty. We have been advised that we need to be politically brave on this issue. And so I suppose my question to you is are you prepared to be politically brave on this issue? Can you give us some examples of what you believe we can do and some timeframes? Because this is actually such an important question that we need to know within what timeframes we are looking at measuring our outcomes.
Well, can I say that? I mean, I agree entirely with Carol Mochan's assessment, and I agree entirely with her plea to every decision maker and every policy maker that tackling poverty and inequality has got to be the root of our mission here in Scotland, because it touches upon every other every portfolio within government, without a shadow of a doubt. So I won't rehearse everything I said previously about the good working we're doing with the DFM. To answer a question, it requires you to be politically brave and politically bold. Yes, absolutely. And that's a challenge we're up for. And of course, we've doubled the child payment once again, committed to double the child payment once again, which I know is something that Scottish Labour had been calling for and had welcomed. So there's a number of initiatives. As you'll also know, of course, that we've committed to the Family Wellbeing Fund again over the course of this parliament, which is a significant investment designed to tackle child poverty. Some of these investments will take the course of the parliamentary term. There's no getting away from that. If I could, if we were able to meet our child poverty targets sooner, of course, then we'd absolutely do that. But I think Ms. Mock is probably quite aware of the detail of those child poverty targets, and therefore I won't rehearse them necessarily in detail here. But I just give her an absolute commitment that whether it's health, education, whether it's transport, housing, social justice, we are all absolutely at one on this drive towards reducing child poverty. And as a person who is responsible for the largest share by quite a distance of the Scottish budget, then I'm not unaware of my responsibilities in that respect too.
Hello.
Yeah, I'm interested that some of the evidence that's come from the Scottish Government is to use the place-based community-led approach. And I just wondered if you could give some examples of where he feels that will make a difference.
Forgive me, Ms. Hedges, did you say about the place-based community-led approach?
Community-led approach, yes, that's very much in the papers. Just I wondered if you had some examples of where you felt that would be something we could use quickly for people.
Yeah. Again, I suspect probably me and Ms. Mockin are one in terms of our belief in the importance of that place-based community-led approach. So, we'll bring together a whole range of work focused on supporting local level action to improve health and wellbeing and reducing health inequalities with that very long-term preventative focus we've already spoken on. So, we want to support health and social care services to work very much as part of wider systems to co-create wellbeing locally, and that enables our health and social care providers to play their role. So they play their role as anchor institutions as part of that community wealth building. So, and there's many good examples of that. A good example of that would be the joint pilot programme that started earlier last year, involving Link Up Gallatown, Kirkcaldy YMCA and NHS Fife, where local people that provided training and placement opportunities in a local hospital. Many have then gone on to secure employment. Parkhead, which I've already referenced, is another good example. This will be our single biggest investment in a health and social care centre, and it'll bring together community services that are currently located in almost 10 other sites, I think nine other sites. And I spoke to the doctor, one of the doctors involved at the moment in one of those sites, who's part of the Deep End project, which brings together 100 of those GP practices in the most deprived areas. And she can absolutely see the value of the work we're looking to do in that respect.
Thank you, Carol. Am I able to move on?
No, I know we're short for time, but I hope we can just make a commitment to come back on this issue. Thank you.
Of course we will. And can I just have some final questions from David Torrance on linking the budget to outcomes. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Cabinet Secretary. The National Performance Framework has 9 indicators and targets for health. How does that fit in with other performance frameworks, like the local delivery plan, standards and integration of health and wellbeing outcomes? And can I ask, which has a greater prominence in setting budgets and spending decisions?
I think I got the end of that question. So essentially, the outcomes set out in the National Performance Framework, they're a consistent thread that runs through our work, and these inform our planning right across the board. So in terms of prominence in influencing spending decisions, which I think you asked for, I mean, it goes through everything that we think about. Every time we make a spending decision, we look at the outcomes of the National Performance Framework, some of the other frameworks that he mentioned as well. But the National Performance Framework really is our guiding framework and for the whole of government. So I mean, it's a consistent thread, as I say, that runs through all of our work and informs our planning across the board.
David?
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, all the information is gathered and evidence in the National Performance Framework. Has it ever led to definite specific changes in your budget plans?
It's a good question. I mean, the National Performance Framework informs the budget. The impacts of commitments on outcomes is, of course, considered when we make commitments, and this in turn informs our budget. You know, for example, you know, is increasing health and care spending will directly contribute to the health and well-being of the nation, right? So we know that, and the First Minister often talks about how you can't separate health and the economy is sometimes people ask us to do. They're intrinsically linked. You know, increased workforce contributes to the economy, as does increased capital investment, which in health, which generates jobs, also moves us towards our net zero goals as well. So, you know, and our commitments to fair work and pay, they contribute to our outcomes around poverty, and health again has a role to play in each and every single one of them. So, yes, absolutely, you know, it sets our budget priorities. And as I said in my previous answers, a consistent thread that runs throughout that entire consideration.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, David. And that concludes our questions to the Cabinet Secretary on the budget. I want to thank Hamza Yousaf, Cabinet Secretary, and Richard McCallum for the time this morning. At our next meeting on the 11th of January, the committee will take evidence from stakeholders as part of our inquiry into health and wellbeing of children and young people. The committee will also undertake scrutiny on the draft mesh reimbursement scheme provided by the Scottish Government in advance of Stage 2 consideration of the Transvaginal Mesh Removal Cost Reimbursement Scotland Bill at its last meeting on the 14th of December. But since this is our last meeting of 2021, let me take this opportunity to send my good wishes and our committee's good wishes to all our stakeholders who've helped us over the year. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.